High up in California's Sierra Nevada mountains, near snowpack-filled lakes, there lives one of the greatest threats to biodiversity in human history. That threat is a recently discovered fungus, and its victims are these guys. Yes, frogs. In this case, the extremely rare yellow-legged frog. These elusive amphibians have lost over 80% of their population due to an extremely deadly fungal infection, and they are the only species at risk. The frogs are part of a larger global amphibian crisis that has brought 32% of all the known species of frogs, salamanders, and caecilians to the brink of extinction, in no small part due to this fungus. This loss of biodiversity threatens to have a wide-ranging impact, from disrupting habitats to preventing the advancement of medical research. Now, scientists are heading out to the mountains in an effort to save this important species before it's too late.
When we talk about mountain yellow-legged frogs, we're really talking about two species, Rana muscosa, which is the southern species, and Rana sierrae, which is the northern species that occurs north of Mather Pass. Both species are very closely related, and they both live in very high alpine lakes, usually above 8,000 feet.
These unique frogs weren't always rare. In fact, their numbers were abundant before more people began to settle around the Sierra Nevada mountains in the late 1800s.
There are, you know, reports of people in the early 1920s, you know, not being able to walk through a meadow without stepping on a frog.
Those same settlers led to the initial decline of the frog population. In order to attract tourists and fishermen, they brought non-native fish species to the Sierra, specifically trout. Trout happen to feed on tadpoles and young frogs, so unsurprisingly, the amount of frogs in the Sierra quickly plummeted when they arrived. The fish started being removed in the 1990s, and that did lead to a rebound, but a far greater threat was on the horizon.
Unfortunately, not very long after that is when the fungal disease chytridiomycosis came through the Sierra Nevadas.
Chytridiomycosis is caused by the fungus Batrachochytrium dendrobatidis.
We sometimes just call it BD for short. Sometimes we just call it chytrid.
It was only first written about in 1998, so there's still a lot we don't know about this disease. But its discovery has been a huge breakthrough in understanding why amphibian populations have been declining so rapidly. And unfortunately,
it also has somehow spread literally throughout the world. So on every continent where frogs exist, chytridiomycosis also exists. It's responsible for a third of the world's amphibians becoming threatened. We already believe that about 100 species have gone extinct because of chytridiomycosis.
Of course, there are other factors that are affecting amphibian populations, like habitat loss, invasive species, and climate change. But chytrid is recognized as a major factor, and its lethal effects can be attributed to the unique way that a frog can breathe.
So frogs osmoregulate through their skin, which just means that their skin is permeable and water and gases can really kind of pass through the skin. Frogs can stay underwater for a very long period of time because they can absorb oxygen through their skin that way. Unfortunately, it also means they can absorb fungal spores, and those fungal spores, when their body reacts to it, what it does is it tries to slough off that infected skin, and it's impossible for them to slough off enough to get rid of it, and eventually what happens is they die of heart failure.
So once the fungus is present in the water, there's really no way for the frogs to get around it.
I think what makes it so difficult is that it's so ubiquitous just in the water supply. You know, how do you treat the entire range of the Sierra Nevada mountains?
Since treating native habitat is out, that means the frogs must be inoculated back at the lab at the Oakland Zoo. Fortunately, the researchers here have a plan to treat and release their yellow-legged patients back into the wild. And the solution starts by getting to the frogs early, before they're technically frogs at all.
Chytridiomycosis really just affects the keratin on the frog. Keratin is, you know, on a human, it's like your fingernails or your hair, that kind of thing. But on frogs, their keratin, their keratinized skin is really in that webbing between their toes and on the inside of their thighs. It's where the skin is more permeable. As tadpoles, the only keratinized part of the body is the mouth parts. And so it doesn't seem to have a major effect on tadpoles.
But just getting a hold of some tadpoles is an ordeal. Because of the frog's remote habitat, a helicopter trip courtesy of a partnership with the California Department of Fish and Wildlife is needed to retrieve the healthy tadpoles from their mountainous dwelling. Once in the lab, Rouser's team raise the frogs under optimal conditions until they're ready for a high-tech upgrade.
Our goal is to bring them up to a size of 40 millimeters measured from their tip of their snout to the tip of their back end. It's called a snout vent length. And the reason for that is because then we can implant them with a microchip.
So basically, frog cyborgs.
It's just like the microchip that you would use for your dog or cat. That allows us then to track those frogs over the long term after they've been released.
Okay, maybe not full-on cyborgs, but the implanted microchip does allow the California Department of Fish and Wildlife to scan the frogs and track them for several years after being released into the wild. Once they're fully formed and ready, the frogs are intentionally exposed to the fungus, which is done under close supervision, of course.
We actually test them every single week. We treat them at about 3 weeks or when they reach 600,000 copies of the critical infection intensity. So ideally, we want them to develop a moderate level of infection, allow their immune systems to kick in, and then we treat them. And then that way, when they go back to the wild and they're released, they may get a moderate level of the infection, but they're never gonna get so sick that it's gonna kill them.
After the frogs have been microchipped, treated, observed, and have built up an immunity to chytrid, it's back to the helicopter for return to their home in the mountains. It may seem like a lot of work for a small group of rare frogs, but amphibians are much more important to people than may be readily apparent.
Not everybody notices their inherent beauty and worth. What I usually say to people is, well, how do you feel about mosquito-borne illnesses? There are a lot of problems that can be caused by mosquitoes, and frogs eat mosquitoes. The other thing is that tomorrow's medicines may come from frogs.
In addition to being vital to medical research and saving us from mosquito-borne illnesses, which honestly already seems like enough, frogs can also tell us about how healthy our ecosystem is and what dangers might be right around the corner.
Frogs are considered an indicator species, which means that because they are very sensitive and absorbed through their skin, they're gonna be the first thing to react to some sort of pollutant or chemical in your system. And because they're amphibians, they can alert you to problems on water and on land.